Hello folks, in these next set of videos I'll be describing to you about the process technology or the different steps which are involved in making the chips that you see on your iPad or your iPhone or your laptop computer, and we'll be going into pretty gory details of how these chips are made, what are the different steps involved. But before I get into the nitty-gritty of that, I want to give you a feel of how these actual chips look when you open them up. So if you open up, say, your microprocessor or your memory chip, what does it actually look like if you take a picture from the top or if you take a cross-section view? So I want to just briefly describe to you in this video that about three of these chips, the first being the microprocessor, or this A5X microprocessor that you see in your iPad. And then the second chip I want to describe you is this DRAM chip. And the third chip I want to describe is this NAND flash memory. And these are the typical three components that you'll see in any mobile devices. You'll always find a microprocessor, you'll always find a DRAM chip. This DRAM chip sometimes is standalone, sometimes it's actually stacked on top of your microprocessor to save space on your board. And you'll always almost always find a NAND flash memory to store your apps and store your data as well. So let's start with this microprocessor. So if you open up this microprocessor and look at its die, this is how it looks like. So these shown here are three generations of these microprocessor chips, starting from A4 to A5 to A5X. And an interesting observation about these dies is that more than 50% of the area here, or more than half of the area on these die, is covered by these, is occupied by these SRAM cells. So if you take 10 pictures of on these die from the top, there's a large chance that five of them would look something like this. So shown here is a 6 transistor SRAM cell. So shown here is one of these unit cells, which is a 6 transistor SRAM cells. And shown here is the circuit diagram for this cell. So this SRAM cells is essentially, it consists of 6 transistors. Two of them, it consists of two of these inverters, one of them drawn in green and the other one drawn in blue, and they are cross connected. And then you have these two pass gate transistors which connect, which are used to essentially read the state of the cell. So if you look at this picture over here, you know, one wonders, this looks nothing like, you know, the circuit diagram. So where are these transistors located? So let me help you out a little bit. So let me help you out in locating these transistors. So these parallel lines over here, these are essentially the gate lines. And these perpendicular lines over here, these are the active lines. So shown here are these two set of lines. One of them are gate and the other one are active area. And so now let's try to locate these transistors. So we see that this inverter has an inverter here. So the gate of these two transistors must be connected, and then they must be connected to the source drain of these other two transistors. So two of these transistors, which are shown in green over here, they can be located over here. So there's a gate line running over here. So this is one of these transistors, and this is the other of these green transistors. And then the gate of this is connected to the source and drain of these second inverter. And also the source drain of these two are connected, so these two would be connected. This would be in another layer, which is not shown over here. And let's look at this other inverter. So this other inverter in blue could be drawn over here, so there would be this gate, and this gate line is running common, so this would be the other transistor, and then they are connected to the source and drain of this first inverter, and then the source and drain of the second inverter would be connected to, and the gate of this first inverter would then connect to the source drain of the second inverter. So shown here are these two inverters, and then they are connected using these pass gate transistors, which are located over here. So this is the first pass gate transistor, and this is the second pass gate transistor. So now we have been able to locate these are two pass gate transistors, and then there are these two inverters. So this is how the circuit diagram translates onto this top view. And this is the most compact way you can pack these six transistors onto your die. Now that we have enjoyed the aerial view, let's look at side view. So if we take a cross section of this die, and look at it sideways, this is how it looks like. So this is an image courtesy from Chipworks, and this shows how this looks like from the side. So you can see these individual transistors, which would be somewhere over here, and then you have these vias, which are connecting these transistors to these interconnect lines. So you see multiple of these interconnect lines, metal 1, metal 2, metal 7, and these are essentially routing all the signals between these SRAM and then your logic circuitry and so on and so forth. And this is showing a cross-section view of A5 microprocessor from your iPad. If you take a cross-section of your chip that is on your laptop, so this is showing a cross-section view of Ivy Bridge processor, or similar to Ivy Bridge processor from Intel. So this is how it would look like. Again, you have your transistor located somewhere over here, and then you have again these multiple levels of interconnect. So this would be metal 1, metal 2, all the way up to, I think they have 9 levels of these interconnect. And so the interconnects are slightly different between your A5 microprocessor and the chip from Intel. So the chip A5 microprocessor, you see that there are these two sets of pitches between your interconnects. So all your metal 1 to metal 4 have one pitch, and then the layers above them have another pitch. In the Intel microprocessor, you see that all of these levels of metals have different pitch. So if the pitch here is X, the pitch here is maybe 1.4X, and then the pitch of each of these interconnects is continuously increasing, as can be shown over here, because they want to optimize the performance or minimize the delay that you get from your interconnect. So this is really optimized for performance to the very core, where over here you are just living with maybe two or three levels of pitches for your metal interconnects. So again, if you really zoom in over here, you can locate these transistors. So shown here is a 32 nanometer transistor from Intel. And over here you can see the source and the drain, and this is the gate, and there's a high K layer over here, and then these are the contact plugs, which are connecting your source and drain and connecting them to the interconnects above. We took a look at the microprocessor chip, so now let's examine the DRAM chip. So if you open up a DRAM die, this is how it looks like. So most of the area on your DRAM chip is occupied by these banks of memory. So each of them has many of these DRAM cells. Each DRAM cell is essentially a one transistor, one capacitor cell. And you have 8 of these DRAM banks shown over here. In the middle also you have this controller circuitry. So what this controller circuitry does is it takes the command from your microprocessor and it decodes into this column address and this row address to go and read that, to read or write that particular cell. And so majority of the area over here is occupied by this banks of cells. And so if you took a cross section, there's a very large percentage that you will land up on something which looks like this. And the first thing that, you know, if you look at this cross section is, gee, you know, what the heck is this, you know? So it looks something like either an antenna hanging in the sky, or it looks like this looks like a horn of a deer, right? So it looks like either an antenna or a horn of a deer. So what is this? You know, we were supposed to have this nice one transistor, one capacitor. So where is the transistor, first of all? So if you look very carefully, the transistor is located somewhere over here. So you'll have your transistor located somewhere over here. So this is your access transistor. And this antenna, or these set of horns hanging in the sky, these are actually the capacitor. So the way a DRAM cell works, let me give you a very quick intro. So the way a DRAM cell works is that you store charge on this capacitor, and then you have this access transistor whose purpose is to essentially help access the charge on this capacitor. So if this capacitor is charged and you turn this transistor on, that charge will get transferred on this bit line, and then you sense that voltage increase in the bit line due to this charge, and that's how you read the state of this cell. So a few requirements on this capacitor: that you want it to have as high a capacitance as possible so it can store a large quantity of charge. Also on this transistor, one of the main requirement is that it should have low off current, so that this charge which is stored in your capacitor does not leak away through this transistor. So this antenna is this capacitor, and it's a MIM capacitor. So you have a metal and you have an insulator and you have another metal. So if you take a more closer look at this, it on this capacitor, it looks like this. So you have two of these metal layers. So you have one of these metal layers, which is tinitride. So you have one layer of tinitride here. You have another of this metal layer. So this is two metal layers, metal, and then another metal layer, both of them being tinitride. And in between you have this insulator layer. So in between you have this aluminum oxide, which is an insulator, and that essentially makes up this transistor. So if make up this capacitor. So again, if you take a top view, it would look something like this. So you'll have these multiple of these antennas or horns hanging up in the sky. So you want to make the capacitor as capacitance of this capacitor as large as possible. So one way to do that is essentially increase the height of this antenna. So you can keep on increasing, make it taller and taller. But again, one of the challenges there is that these structures should not collapse. If they collapse, they will short each other. So you definitely don't want that to happen. And the way it's designed like an antenna is again to maximize this capacitance. So shown in this cartoon is this one transistor, one capacitor design. So you have a transistor over here, which is an access transistor. and then you have this capacitor, and this is called a stacked capacitor design, because your capacitor is stacked on top of your transistors. And again, one way to increase the capacitance is to increase the surface area of this capacitor. So one way to increase the surface area is to essentially hollow this capacitor out. And now you get both surface area on the outside and you get surface area on the inside. So that's why it's designed like an antenna. So you get both the surface area on the outside and then you get the surface area on the inside. And in some design, you actually roughen the surface as well. So you make the surface rough, because essentially, again, that increases your surface area, which increases the capacitance of this capacitor.